So looks like it is taking more time than the usual. So let me stop it and then I'll try to execute it again. So let's check whether it is dropped or not. So it is there, right? So now again I'll try to drop the column. Sometimes it will not respond fastly.
Can you explain it again till it get executed?
What?
Can you explain the procedure once again until it get executed?
The view?
Yeah.
Okay. So a view is nothing but an imaginary object in a database. So it is used to create or to restrict existing table data. See, basically in a table we'll be maintaining overall data. Right, if let's say if it is business is there across the globe, so then all the countries, or maybe let's take within a country, all the states information will be available. So but if you want to give only specific location related data access to particular developers, then we have to create a view on top of the table with filters, and then instead of giving access to the main table, we can give access to the created view to the user so that he can access this view, and which is having only data related to specific country or specific state, irrespective of having the full geography data, right? So, and one more thing, we can give access to the view, but if let's say if the admin guy has forgot to disable access to view the table script here in the tables, the developer can check the script of your view, which table it is referring, right? And then he can catch the main table name. So to avoid that, we can create a view with encryption option. So with encryption option, what it will do is, it will not allow the user or developer to check the creation script of a view. So if you use with encryption, we cannot, the developer cannot view the script, creation script of a view, so that he cannot get to know from which table this view has been created. All right, he doesn't know. So he cannot access the table as well, and also cannot able to check the view creation script. So that is one thing with encryption. So now what we are trying to do is, I am trying to drop a column, right? I think which is taking time. So instead of that, so I can also tell you one more example of this, what I'm gonna do now. Yeah. Okay, I think since it is a foreign key, it will not drop it. It will take some time. Yeah, see here, city, there is envercar of 30, right? So we'll try to alter the data type. We'll give envercar of 40. We'll check what happens, right? So alter column city, and then I'll just give envercar of 40. Right? So let me execute this. It should change to envercar of 40. Sorry, I had given NA. Why today everything is taking slow?
Amar?
Yeah.
Why you are using particularly alter? If we want any data, so directly we can give select store from table name, where that one, where part we can give. So directly it gets the data. So particularly alter view, when can we use that? How can we know that as a developer?
No, alter view is altering the script. That's what it, see, this is the whole creation script of a view, right? This part. Okay. So if you are changing any script to the view, you have to alter it, right? So existing, once you create it, you have to alter if you want to modify the code of it. That's okay. The reason I used alter. See, here also for a table, once you create a table and if you want to change any data type, we are using alter, right? So alter is used to modify the existing table. The same way, alter is used to modify the existing view. That's it.
means existing table.
Existing view.
Use it to alter view. Okay.
Same we are using for existing table also here, right?
Alter yes, command. Yes, column. Yeah.
The same way we are using alter for view.
To means change to change the data. Change
not
the
to
data
change the data,
in the
to
table.
Change the created script, not the data.
Yeah.
The view does not hold the data. I'll repeat it. View will hold only the creation script of the view. That's it.
Okay.
Backgroundly, if you execute a view, it will fetch data from the created script of a view, which is table from this one.
Okay. That one developer will have access for that.
Yes.
But not seeing the script.
Correct. See, guys, I think it is taking time. I'm not sure. Maybe network issues or no, don't know. See, what I'm trying to say is, see, now if I try to alter the column data type, it is trying to execute, right? So what happens, you know, if you try to drop the column and next time if you select star, if you do select star from view, the view is created on sales territory key table as well, key column as well. But if you drop it, if you do select star from view, that column doesn't exist, right? So it is a problem. You should not drop any column or you should not increase the size of any column on a base table if you have created a view, right? So you should not alter the base table since you have created a view, right? So to avoid that, so to not to allow the developer to change the scripts of a base table, we have one option which is schema binding. If you use with schema binding and if you create a view, see, for schema binding we should not use the star, we have to use the column list. So let me choose the columns. For few options it doesn't allow the star, so one of them is schema binding. Yeah. See, now I have created a view or altered a view with schema binding option. So what happens, you know, if you try to alter the table, it will throw error. I think still again it is taking time. Yes, maybe you can try it in your system. So if not, I'll tell you again tomorrow. It is taking than the usual more time. See now, once you create a view with the schema binding, if you try to alter data type or if you try to drop any column from that base table which the view has been created, it will not allow if you use the schema binding option. All right, so try that one. It will not allow, right? Or else maybe instead of AdventureWorks, let me quickly try with our database, which is October database tables. All right, so let me create one view from October database. Create view. View name VW underscore employee. And then as selected. Right. So this will create the view on employee table. I forgot to give the keyword view. Right? Yeah, you can see the view now. So now if I try to alter this table, so alter table, table name. And then alter, if I try to change the data type of any column, EMP name, worker of 30 I'll give instead of 20, right? It will allow. Command completed successfully, right? If I right click and then refresh, you can see that the employee name data type has been changed to worker of 30. All right. So now it will not be any problem with this view if you do select star from, but if you remove the column, then only the problem will come. I'll show you the both examples. Since we are just increase the length, but it is allowing, right? So if let's say if I try to drop the column, so let me drop the column. Both the scenarios I'll tell you. The first scenario is I try to alter the column data type, it allowed. The second scenario, I'm just dropping the column. Drop column, which is employee H on the base table, right? The command completed successfully. Now, if I try to do select star from view, what did he say? Invalid column name, employee H. Why? We have created a view with the help of a base table. And the base table with the columns employee ID, employee name, and then employee age. But we try to drop the column employee age from the base table. Now, if you are trying to execute select star from view, it will throw error. Why? Because a view is created with employee age column as well, but now employee age column is not there in the table, right? This is a problem, right? In real time. So, suddenly, if you drop any column from the base table, the users are accessing this view. So they cannot access the view, right? So to restrict that employee not to change the scripts, we have an option called schema binding. We can create a view with schema binding option. So guys, I'm re-adding that column, alter table, table name, add column employee age, right? So now I can access that, let it be null values also. Now I'm altering the view with schema binding option, alter view, view name. With schema binding should be first and then hash. Yeah. What it is throwing error, guys? Can you read it? There will be a lot of problems with changing the scripts. What do you think the issue is? So must be two part, right? So it is saying when you use the with the schema binding option, here the from table name should be the two part, which means here we have three parts, right? Database name dot dbo dot employee name. It should be two part. So we have to remove the database name here. So if you are using schema binding, you should not use database name. Why? Because when you are using a schema binding, we cannot create a view on some other database tables here. So you have to use within the database tables. That's the reason why it will not accept the three part table name, which is database name dot schema name dot table name. It will accept only two part, which is schema name dot table name. Command completed successfully, right? So now if I try to alter it or drop it, what it is doing? Can you read out the error message or my error message, guys? Did you all get it with the option schema binding? What exactly it will do? So with the schema binding, if you use, if you try to change or alter the base table data type, or if you're trying to drop the column, it will not allow. Why? Because the object view is dependent on the column employee name. Alter column failed because one or more objects access this column. So there is a dependent objects on this column. So you are not allowed to change the data type, or you are not allowed to drop the column from this table. So that's the option of with schema binding while creating a view or while altering a view. Any questions, guys? With encryption, will restrict the developer not to view the view script. With schema binding, will restrict the user not to change the base table structure. Clear? Okay, if there are no concerns, we'll start with next topic. You can ask me, Minal, if you have any questions, guys. The next topic is indexes. Yeah. So, guys, indexes, there is no much functionality with practical part. It is just a simple statement. Create index name on table name. But there is a lot with theoretical part with indexes, right? So basically indexes are used, I'll give the definition. Indexes are used to retrieve, or indexes are used to speed up the query retrieval performance. Right? So which means, let's say if you're writing any code, like I took an example of here, a join code, right? So here, but since we have less data here, it will run faster. If let's see in real time, if you have huge volume of records, then it will take some time, right? Let's say here we have huge volume of records when you are joining a table, but if you try to execute, it will take some 10 hours to retrieve the data, right? But if you create indexes on these fields, it will run within 10 minutes also. So that much performance improvement will be achieved with the help of indexes concept. That's the reason why the definition of indexes is, indexes are used to speed up the query retrieval performance. We have two types of indexes. The first one is cluster index, and then the second one is non-cluster index. So cluster index, we can create only one cluster index onto a table, whereas we can create triple line non-cluster indexes onto a table, right? So we can create one cluster index, whereas we can create triple line non-cluster index on the table. If we create primary key by default, cluster index will get created. Whereas if you create unique key, by default, non-cluster index will get created, right? If you want that example, so let me show you which table we have created a cluster index. I'll show you. See here, we have created a primary key on employee table on the column EID. So if you go to indexes now here, can you see there is index clustered? So that is what this point here. If you create primary key, by default cluster index will get created. See, pk underscore employee, some index name, and then cluster, right? So that is what that point for the definition. If you create primary key, by default cluster index would get created. But if you create unique key, so on which table we have created unique key? I think the department. Here on the department ID we have created unique key, and we can see a non-clustered index, right? So if you create unique key, by default non-clustered index will get created. But don't think, guys, if you create indexes, primary key will not be created, vice versa will not happen. Only if you create primary key, then only cluster index will get created. But if there is no primary key under your table, and if you create indexes, it will not create the primary key. Vice versa will not happen. Only the one way will happen, which is if you create a primary key, cluster index will get created. If you create a unique key, the non-cluster index will get created, right? So why we can create only one non-cluster index on the table? The first point, right? So why? Because, see, once you create a cluster index, the physical structure of the table will get altered, which means, let's say employee ID values are clumsy in the sense, the first 2222 is there, and next 1000 is there, and next 2000, and then 3333, something like that. So the values are not in a proper order. So what it will do is, cluster index, once you create a cluster index, the physical structure of the data will be altered, which means it will do the sorting, internal sorting by default, and it will store the data in proper order. So we cannot maintain multiple table orders, right? So it has to be a combination. So we cannot modify the table structure or table data physically on multiple columns. So that is the only reason we cannot create multiple cluster index under a table. But we can create cluster index on multiple columns if you create index, if you create a primary key on multiple columns. Guys, do you know, can we create a primary key on more than, or can we create can we create a primary key on more than one column? Is it possible, guys?
No.
How?
Primary key will only one is allowed for a table, right?
Mm-hmm.
By using unique and not null combination, we can create.
By using any
primary keys. Okay. Yeah.
Okay. But try to give, try to create a primary key by mentioning multiple columns, right? Maybe alter table. I'm just giving the syntax here. Table name, add constraint. PK underscore some name, and then under table name, add constraint name, primary key of EID comma name. This way you can create a primary key on multiple columns. So at the time of this will call it as a composite primary key. This type of creating a primary key, we'll call it as a composite primary key. I guess there was a lot of background noise was coming from my side, so I muted my audio. So yeah, in this way we can create a composite primary key. Try this way, okay? But try to give both the integer columns. You can create a specific table, and after creating, maybe employee ID and then department ID. But if you create a primary key, the combination also should be unique, guys. You know, right? That concept of primary key. So it should not allow the duplicates. It should not be null values, right? So the combination should not be a duplicate. So basically in real time, we'll create a composite primary key on employee ID column and then date field. Right? Why? Because the same employee record can be inserted on multiple days, right? The same employee can, or the same customer can purchase products on multiple dates, right? So in that case, the same employee ID, but multiple dates. So the combination is not duplicated, right? So during that case, we'll create the composite primary keys. Got it? So at the time of creating a primary key itself, we can mention multiple names. Okay. That will be called as a composite primary key. The scenarios will be very rare, but you should know the concept of it, right? Yeah, let's come back to indexes. Any questions till now, guys, on the indexes? Theory part? No questions? Yeah. See, now I just need to mention a few more points here. As we don't have any indexes on this table, do we have indexes? No, right? So since there is no primary key on this table, we'll not be having any indexes on this table. And how about employee? Does the employee table have indexes? Yes. By default, there is a primary key and then indexes will be there, right? So now if I try to execute, so there is an option called here, actual execution plan, right? So I'll highlight it and I'll try to enable this one. There will be option called here, actual execution plan. Click on that. And then now if you execute the select star from table name, it will prepare the execution plan here in the result set, right? Can you see here, nested loop, some table scan, cluster index is performed, the cost is 56% and then 44%, right? So what is this table scan, right? So table scan is nothing but scanning the result set, the full entire table, right? So the data, it will scan the full table and then you will try to retrieve it, which is a costly operation. How to change this one to index seek, right? So if let's say this query is taking more time, assume, and if there is a result set called table scan here in the execution plan, right, which is a costliest operation. And with that, you can decide that there is a column in the join which are not in the part of indexes, right? So if you create indexes, this can be changed to index scan or index seek. Let's try that. So as of now, we don't have index created on the employee table, on the employee ID field, which I have been used in the join condition. So let me create indexes. So to create index, the syntax is create index name, cluster index, and then the name is CIX, which is cluster index underscore. We have to give the index a unique name. Since I'm creating on the employee table and table name underscore, I'm creating on the column employee ID. So that by reading at the name itself, you'll get to know, okay, this is cluster index created on the table EMP and the column name is employee ID, right? So on table name of column name, we have to provide. This is the syntax to create a cluster index on the existing table, right? So create cluster index, index name on employee table, and then the column name, right? So as of now, there is no indexes here. Let me execute it. Index has been created. So let me refresh. Can you see index here with the same name, CIX underscore EMP underscore EID, right? So now let me try to execute this query. Now, can you see here, instead of table scan, it is going for clustered index scan after creating a cluster index on employee ID, on table EMP. Now, both the fields which are using in the join condition are indexed. So both the table columns are in indexed. So that's the reason why the data retrieval is faster. See here, you can see index seek, right? So now, what is the difference between index seek and index scan? There will be an interview question. Now here you can see index scan and here you can see index seek. So difference between index scan versus index seek, right? So for this, I'll take an example. So let me go to Google. We go to images. Can you all see it clearly? So here the table, so let's say this is the, let's take an example of this is a table, it is having 1 to 200 rows. Now you try to filter out data, select star from table where ID equals to some 189. You are filtering out data from the table, which is ID record equals to 189, right? So let's say if there is index or if there is no index. So first, let's discuss about there is no index, which is first list operation. If index is not there, it will take more time, right? So 189. So 189 is present here. And do you think 189 is there here? 1 to 100? No. It will check here also. No. Here also? No. No. Again, it will come back here. Does 189 falls under 51 to 100? No. Here? No. No. This node is done. Again, it will come back to here. Does 189 falls under here? Maybe, yes. Here? No. No? No. Again, it will go back here. Yes. Yes, there is a chance here. Yes. No here. And yes, it is here. So by scanning the full table, it will fetch the result set. That is what the index scan is. So without indexes, see if there is index and if you will not use the indexed field in the where clause filter, it will go for index scan, which is it will scan again the entire table and it will try to fetch the result set. But if you use index seek, which means you have created an index on a table and the same index field you have used in the join field or where clause filter, then the query will go for index seek, which is first it will check 189 will falls under here or not. Then here it will check. Is it falling here? No. Straight away it will go back here. Is 189 falling here? Yes. And then here it will check whether it is falling here. No, it will go back straight away here. And then it will check this side, whether it is falling over here or not. If it is not there, then straight away it will go to this node. So here it is the proper result set value. So how many steps involved here? 1, 2, 3, 4 or 5 maybe, right? But index seek data is retrieved within 5 steps, but here how many steps? 3 plus 4, 7. 7 plus 3, 10 plus 4, 14 steps for index scan, just to retrieve data from out of 200 rows. Got it? So that is the difference of index seek operation and then index scan operation. So if the index scan, it will operate, it will scan the entire table data, entire node. But if the query is using index seek, it will just go for the proper node directly and then it will fetch the result set, which is a fastest operation. That is the difference between index seek and then index scan, guys. You have to explain the same way. Let's say if you take an example of 1 to 200 rows, if it is index scan, it will try to scan the entire table and then it will fetch the result set. But if it is using IndexSeq, then it will directly go to the desired node and it will fetch the result set. So always IndexSeq is faster than the index scan, right? Clear the difference between IndexSeq and then index scan? Guys, this concept is more of into a theoretical part than the practical. See, practical is just this statement. Create cluster index, index name on table name, that's it. But there is a lot of information backgroundly, the theoretical part of cluster indexes or non-cluster, the overall indexes concept, right? But this is very important being experienced, guys. We are going to keep some experience, right? So it is very important and definitely there will be a question on indexes concept, right? So please go through this and then tomorrow we'll continue from here again. There are a few more concepts I need to cover in indexes. We'll continue tomorrow. And then I'll start with user-defined functions. If you have time, you can read out some notes on this indexes and then user-defined functions. Okay. Yeah, I think it's time up, guys. That's it for today. We'll connect tomorrow. Thanks for joining.